eventually, some of the online threats that I faced got to the point where I had to carry a security alarm and have security escorts back and forth from Parliament. And I think what really made that scary was that it was after the March 15th terror attacks had happened. We know what's possible, really, really, we know. And I think we need to remember that it actually is a scary time, much more for the people out there in that community who aren't in the privileged position that I'm in. You know, they don't get to have a security escort when they walk their kids to school or their granddads are going off to mosque. It's remembering that really kind of motivates me to keep talking about these issues. I kept getting offers to write the book, and I felt like I didn't have enough political career under my belt, I didn't have enough life under my belt to write an autobiography just yet. And I think the thing that tipped it is talking to other refugee background women and how we didn't really, and that kind of idea that we don't really have our stories told. And I realised actually it doesn't have to be about politics, it doesn't have to be about me as an MP. It can just be the story of growing up in Aotearoa, being from a different kind of background. When I think about my life in Iran, I remember a lot of joy because it was warm and close-knit community and family life. But I also remember this sort of visceral tension and fear that never ever left us. And I've never really felt again. I have a chapter in the book that's all about Karangahape Road because I grew up here and I found myself here. It used to be a hub of the Pasifika community. It's close to where the dawn raids happened. It's also been the red light district. It's been a home for the rainbow community. It's about diversity in a really special way, and it's about those really marginalized communities finding a home. Representation, or having that plurality of voices in lawmaking and policymaking and any decision-making body, is crucial because we do experience the world differently. Women accessing the healthcare system has different needs than a man or a gender-diverse person, and a woman of colour has a different experience of, say, the justice system, and a young person has a different experience of the job market. We know that. And those experiences are valuable in and of themselves.
But today, Mr. Speaker, I also want to acknowledge those who tell me every day that I don't belong here, that I should go home where I came from, that I should have been left to die, that I have no right to criticise any politician in this country or take part in public life, because this isn't my home. Mr. Speaker, some of them call for rifles to be loaded. It gets frightening.
I wrote that speech having just learnt how important representation was to some of the groups that saw representation in me. That was the refugee communities, Middle Easterners, the Muslim community even, because I was perceived as being Muslim and I was receiving all of the hate that those communities also receive on a mass scale. So I knew that I couldn't leave that out of my maiden speech. I don't think it sank in.
Some breaking news after reports of a shooting in central Christchurch this afternoon.
Simon, it's chaos here in Hagley Park, really. You can probably hear the sirens going past me.
I think the lessons of March 15 have begun to sink in, but it is just the beginning. And the true lesson is whether we take that on and make lasting change. I think you beat the trolls by continuing to exist. They're not going to win because we're going to keep turning up and acting like we have a right to be here. I think the best advice that I've received is not to fight fear and anxiety, to sit with them and allow them as part of life and make room for them. It's much easier, it takes way less energy.